Sing it over you. Here is my worship, my offering, to be fully given. It's my one thing to be a fragrance, to shine like your face, to be your dwelling, your resting place. Here's my worship. Here is my worship, my offering, my offering, to be fully given, to be fully given. This is my one thing. It's my one thing to be a fragrance, to be a fragrance, to shine like your face, like your face, to be your dwelling, to be your dwelling, your resting place, your resting place. Here's my worship. Here is my worship, my offering, to be fully given, to be fully given. It's my one thing.
It's my one thing
to be a fragrance,
to be a fragrance,
to shine like your face,
like your face,
to be your dwelling,
to be your dwelling,
your resting place.
Here is my worship,
my
offering,
to be fully given,
to be fully given.
It's my God, immortal, invisible, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Who there is none like, hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Alone you are God. Alone you are God. None God can compare, and I'm so glad. I'm so glad, God, that none can compare to you, Jesus. Because you are God alone, and I know that if my life is hidden in yours, that if my life is in your hands, it is well taken care of, God. Hallelujah.
You are God alone, and right now,
before time began. You were on your cross, and you were God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you were on your cross, you were God alone. You are God alone. From before time began, you were on your cross.
From God, hallelujah. If he has said it, you can stand.
That's who you are. That's who you are. That's who you are.
That's who you are.
That's who you are. Presence, God. Thank you for your sweet presence, God. Oh God, we thank you for your sweet presence. We say, come in and dwell. Come in and find rest, God, in our praise. Jesus. We want you badly, God. We need you badly, God. How badly do you want, God? That's all he's been saying to me this week. How badly do you want me? I will fill you to the degree that you want me. I want you badly, God. I want you badly. Or goodly. I'm going to search, God, until I find your fullness. And I know your fullness is there, and it's me, not you. I know I just need to open my eyes and expand my capacity, Lord, to gaze on your fullness. I know it's not you, God. I know it's me. But I contend for you, God. I will search until I find your fullness, or all of the fullness that I can this side of heaven. I will keep pressing and I will keep searching. Your word says that I will find you if I search for you with all of my heart, God. And I declare this morning in front of this congregation that I will search with all of my heart for you, Jesus.
How truly
I was glad when they said to me, come, let us go into the house of the Lord. Because here truly, O God, among my family, God, among my brothers and sisters, God, we are one and we are searching with single eye focus for you, God. We're doing it together, God. We're going after you together, God. We're not going to let any fall by the wayside, God. We're going together. We will be known by our love. I declare new dimensions. You will be known by your love. I declare that today. You will be known by your love. Hallelujah. We'll be known as the Love Church. Go down by new dimensions. All you're going to get down there is love. Love, love.
Yes,
the love one another.
Amen.
The love whoever comes. The love God first. And if we don't love God first, we can't love ourselves. We can't love each other. And so I declare love. I declare love. I declare love. And in a demonstration of love, look for somebody and hug them and tell them you love them. Look for somebody and hug them and tell them you love them. Maybe the only hug that they get today may not get any other hugs today, so do something. Say, I love you with the love of the Lord. I love you with my own love. I just love you. New Dimensions, I love you. Band, I love you. Junie, I love you. Dave, I love you. Lavera, I love you. Corey, I love you. Brian, I love you. Patrick, I love you. Janelle, I love you. Ann, I love you. Stacy, I love you. Susan, I love you. Keola, I love you. Pastor, I love you. Apostle, I love you. Eldership, I love you. Shane, I love you. Elder Harriet, I love you. Elder Dwayne, I love you. Everybody, I love you. 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 Hallelujah. 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 You heard about the love boat. Well, this is the love church. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. Jesus. Love divine, all love excelling. Joy of heaven to earth come down. Love divine, all love excelling. Joy of heaven and earth come down. Love divine, all love's excelling. Joy of heaven and earth come down. Come down, God. Come down. Come down, God. Come down.
heaven and earth touch. 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 Heaven and earth.
Hallelujah. Make us one, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Make us one, God. Make us one flame. Make us one flame to proclaim your name, God. That is our great commission. Make us one, God. Make us one voice. Hallelujah. Make us one heart. Make us one, God, that is my sincere and deep longing and prayer, God. Make us one as you and Holy Spirit and your Son are one, God. Help us to experience that love and that unity, oh God, among the Godhead, Father. Show us a glimpse.
You gave, and I.
God, you've won our affection. Jesus, you've won our affection. You have won our affection, God. The race for us, God, so that we could win the race. You went before us and you showed us, God. You showed us how to finish. We know that if you finish strong, we can finish strong, God. And our eye is on the prize this morning. We will do everything you tell us to do. Individually and corporately, we will do all that you say, God. We commit to you that we are an obedient people, God. Jesus, Jesus, give him the fruit of your lips. Give him your love. Give him your adoration. Oh, what love. Oh, what love. What love, God. Help us to comprehend the height of that love and the depth of that love and the breadth of that love and the width of that love, God. Give us hearts of flesh. Remove our hearts of stone. Soften. Break up the fallow ground, God. Break in upon us. Break in upon us. Break in upon us, God. We need a newness. We smell the fragrance. We smell the freshness and the newness, God. But can we be greedy this morning, God? With your permission, can we be greedy? Can we ask for more? Can we not be satisfied, God? I know you've begun a new thing in us, but can we ask for more? I got a lot of space inside me to fill, God. Can I ask you for more? And I don't want anything else in me but you. I don't have any space or any time for anything else, God, but you and your will, your plans and your purpose, and I will work as unto you, God. I will sing as unto you. I will eat as unto you. I will walk as unto you. Oh, let's just sing a love song to the Lord in your own voice, in your own words. Don't look to the altar to lead. Look to us to lead you. We are broken people in the process of becoming and transforming just as you are. And each one has his own song. Sing your own songs. Sing a new song. Now is not the time to disconnect, church. Now is the time to press in. Don't mind who's around you. Don't mind if you can't sing. Don't mind how you sound. God says your voice is beautiful. He says whenever he opens his mouth in praise, whenever you open your mouth in praise, he accepts it and it is beautiful. He loves your voice. He loves your voice. He loves to hear your voice. Oh, that we would sing, that we would worship, that we would praise our God, that we would lift our voices. Come up, come up, come up. He says, come up, come up. Here I am. He says, come up, come up, come up. I'm waiting for you. Here's my hand. You want a hand? Here it is. I will pull you up. Come up, come up, come up, come up. Come up, come up. Come up to where I dwell. Come up, come up, come up. I love you. There is now no more condemnation in you. You are acceptable. You are washed. You are clean. You can come up into my presence. We can sup together. We can fellowship together. We can sing and we can all talk. Yes, and we can just be in each other's presence. And it can be sweet. It can be sweet. That's what I want from you, my children. I want fellowship with you. God says, I want to fellowship with you. He says, I want to fellowship with you. Come and fellowship with me. I hear the voice of the Lord say, come and fellowship with me. I love you. Come and fellowship with me. I love you. Come and fellowship with me. He says, I love you. Come and fellowship with me.
Hallelujah. Let's enthrone our God. Enthrone him, for he is holy. Enthrone him because he is great. Enthrone him because he is righteous. Enthrone him because he's the only faithful God. Enthrone him. Yes, he is God. Tap him, go in, because he is God. We are in relationship with him. He has given us a brand new covenant. We are his covenant sons, and he is our covenant God. Hallelujah. In Psalm 33:12 says, blessed is the nations who God is Jehovah. God is the God of Barbados. We're going to lift up Barbados this morning. It's the nation that God has given to us. Blessed is the nation whose God is Jehovah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want some of us to turn to the south, wherever you believe the south is. I want some of you to turn to the north of Barbados, wherever you feel the north is. I want some of you to turn to the west and to the east. However the Spirit is laid for you to turn, you turn. Because we are going to bless Barbados. For those who want to look up to the heavens, you can. For we are not going to leave any part of Barbados unturned. The Bible says in Isaiah 26:13, oh Jehovah our God, we call on Jehovah our God this morning. The other gods besides you have had dominion over us, but not anymore. No other God will rule or reign over Barbados. We decree and we declare this morning that God, Jehovah God, reigns over Barbados. He reigns over Barbados. He reigns from the north, he reigns from the south, he reigns from the east, and he reigns from the west. Let us just go in now to God on behalf of Barbados. Father God in heaven, there's no other God beside you that shall reign over this land. Hallelujah. For God alone have multiplied this nation. According to Isaiah chapter 9 verse 3, a God has multiplied this nation. So in the name of Jesus, let's raise our voices together. Let us call on the multiplication of good things in this land. God alone has increased these people with joy in the name of Jesus Christ. I want you to pray.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
There is none like you, God.
Can you give us a war tune? A war tune. Just a war tune. Because we are blessing Barbados. We are blessing Barbados. Continue to pray. We are blessing Barbados. God has given this church in this season a sickle. He has given a sickle for harvest, and he has given the church a sickle for judgment. God has given us a sickle to harvest, and we're going to use this sickle this morning. We're going to harvest the souls in this land in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We use the sickle of God this morning to bring harvest of souls. We decree in the name of Jesus Christ, souls will be drawn unto the King of Kings. Souls from the north, souls from the south, souls from the east, souls from the west. In the name of Jesus Christ, we take the sickle from heaven and we harvest souls. We harvest souls. We say souls shall come into the kingdom. Souls shall come into the kingdom of God. We harvest even now. Jubilee good and wholesome relationships. We decree and we declare that whole and awesome relationships shall come to this land. We declare that there shall be no more divorce, no more dysfunctional families, no more dysfunctional families. We decree that we shall have whole families, we shall have whole relationships destroy every law that is against God and His word. So in the name of Jesus, we take the sickle in the name of Jesus Christ, and we destroy every law that has stand against Christ. We destroy it with a sickle. God, you have given the church authority, and we walk in this authority. We walk in this power in the name of Jesus Christ. So in the name of Jesus, we divorce every other God. We divorce every other God. We divorce the God of Baal. The God of Baal we destroy. We rebuke the spirit of Baal. Now let me tell you something. Baal is responsible for our livestock. Baal is responsible for fruitfulness. He destroys. He brings barrenness to a land. He has destroyed our kings. He has destroyed everything that we want to produce. So in the name of Jesus, let's take the same sickle, and we are destroying the God of Baal. He shall not function in this land of Barbados. We take our sickle and we cut you up in pieces. We say, Baal, you have to leave. You have to get out of this land. For it is surely, it is surely, it is surely, this land is blessed. Because it's
Jubilee.
We rebuke that spirit. We renounce its works. We pull down its strongholds. And we destroy the altars that it's responsible for. We cut it up. We cut up Baal. Baal, get out. Get out of this land. In the name of the Father. In the name of the Son. We chop you up in pieces. The God of Ashtaroth. Now the God of Ashtaroth is responsible for immorality. Yes, it's against everything that called holy. And we decree that Barbados is a holy nation. So we will take the sickle and we then destroy. We are going to cut off the head of Ashtaroth. In the name of Jesus, take the sickle this morning and we will destroy him. With a walk, with a dance, with the sound of the Lord, with the dance of the Lord, with the sickle that's been given to us. For this is Jubilee, it is holiness unto the Barbados, holiness in every part of Barbados. We destroy the spirit of Ashtaroth, not by might, not by power, but by the Holy Spirit of God. We take the sickle, God, just like you take the five stones, and you put power behind it, put power behind the sickle of heaven, so that we'll destroy. Now the spirit of Molech, it destroys your economy. It's a god that says that this economy must be run only by evil men. But as from today, economy goes into the hand of the church. We take that sickle. Let's go for his head. Let's go for his head. Let's take off the head of Molech. Molech, we are not afraid of you in the name of Jesus Christ, because this is Jubilee. Barbados is in its Jubilee. Barbados is blessed. So we declare you will not hold back our economy, neither will it be run by evil men. But we declare that Barbados is blessed. The economy of the church is blessed. The economy of the church is blessed. The economy of Barbados is blessed. And it's going to be run by Almighty God. So Father, send the blessing. Send the blessing in Jesus' name. Send the blessing. One more God we're going after. God has told us to leave Leviathan to him. May I tell you, Leviathan, because he is the God of the sea, he deals with water. And guess what? You and I, we are water. So guess what? He feasts on mankind. He wants to go into the water of our content. And therefore, we have a sickle from heaven. Therefore, it's not we that is fighting. We are leaving Leviathan to the Holy Ghost this morning. But we are going to take that heavenly sickle. And we are going to cut off its fangs. We are going to cut off. We are going to scale him this day. In the name of Jesus Christ. So turn to the north. Turn to the south. For my bodies is surrounded with water. In the name of Jesus Christ, we take the sickle and we cut that to scale of Leviathan. We scale of Leviathan. He shall not take over. He shall not rule my bodies. He shall not rule my bodies. Father, send the angels. Send the angels to sit upon our waters. Send the angels to sit upon the water. In the name of Jesus Christ, send the water. Father, send the water. Send the angels, oh God, to sit upon our waters. Even the waters in our flesh. In the waters of our flesh. We decree, we declare. Leviathan has no more rule. He has no more rule in this land. For it is Jubilee. We bless this mission. We bless its waters. We bless its waters. We bless its rivers. We bless its waters. The blessing of Jubilee upon this land. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In this day. Finally, Isaiah 26 says, in this day, a song shall be sung, a song of Jubilee, for we have a strong city. Salvation will be appointed for our walls and our bulwark. So open the gates that this righteous nation, which shall keep faith, may enter in. So right now, in the name of Jesus, we put down the sickle and we take up a sound and we raise it before our King. We celebrate. We celebrate Isaiah 26:1. We celebrate. We celebrate. For this is Jubilee. This is Jubilee. God give us a song. God give us rejoicing. God give us celebration. It is Jubilee. Yes, it is Jubilee. This nation is blessed.
We are a holy nation.
This nation. It is blessed. Every gates are open. Our gates are open. Heaven's gates are open. We walk on the open heaven. We praise Him. One last dance. One last dance. One last dance.
It is Jubilee.
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 Destroy a place at the same time. Glory.
Barbados, we are a sheep nation.
Yes.
Barbados
is a sheep nation.
Barbados, we are a sheep nation.
It is Jubilee.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let the children come. Let the children come as we will bless them. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We call on all the children. It is Jubilee for them. These are the ones that may more likely see another Jubilee. So we, the older ones, have to rejoice. We may not see another 50 years, but these are the ones that will carry on if God tarry. So in the name of Jesus Christ, Father, can we have some of Dwayne and some of us just walk through these children? Because the spirit of Jubilee is upon you. So Pastor Sandra, let's walk through the children so that the very spirit, in fact, these children catch the spirit already. In the name of Jesus, Father, we pray for these children. We declare Jubilee upon their lives. We pray that injuries can come to them. We declare that they shall be full of joy. We declare that peace will come to their homes. We declare they shall not lack anything. For God, these are yours. These belong to you. And we decree and we declare Jubilee blessing upon each one of them. Jubilee blessing upon the teachers. We say the power of God will fall upon them this morning. We declare the power of God will fall upon them. We decree that the fire of God and His glory will be upon every boy and every girl in the name of Jesus. God, Jubilee shall be in their bones. Jubilee shall be in their spirit. Their jubilee shall be in their soul. We decree that these children shall see bountifulness. They shall see fruitfulness. None of them shall be ignorant, but all of them will connect and embrace the wisdom of God. We decree that they will walk through the gates of wisdom. They will walk through the gates of understanding. They shall walk through the gates of knowledge that comes only from heaven. So in the name of Jesus, one last breath, God, breathe upon these children. Breathe upon these children. Breathe your power. Breathe your glory. Breathe Jubilee over them. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Bless God for the children. Give applause unto God for the children. These are fruitfulness. These are our fruit. These are our fruit. So give God some praise one more time. It is Jubilee. It is Jubilee. It is Jubilee. Hallelujah. You may go. Hallelujah. The Spirit of God upon you as you go to your classes. May the teachers be blessed. May they be highly favored. May they be full of wisdom and understanding and knowledge. God, these are your teachers you have chosen. So let the oil of God from heaven increase on the inside of them, in Jesus' name.
Welcome by Elder Harriet as she comes and give all the announcements. Hallelujah. We can't stop. It's Jubilee. It's good to have her back from a restful holiday.
Amen. It is indeed Jubilee. Good morning to the church. It is so good to be back. and my family in Canada listening and saying, she really saying that? Love y'all. And it's really good to be back as we celebrate Jubilee. And we are expectant concerning Jubilee. As a church, as individuals, as a nation, we are expectant that God will do great things. And the atmosphere of expectancy is the breeding ground for miracles to happen. Amen? So we will constantly walk with the atmosphere of expectancy so that we can see the miracles of God at work. Good morning to everyone. And if you're worshiping with us for the very first time on a Sunday morning, welcome to Jubilee. And we'd like you to stand and remain standing because we want to bless God for you being here with us. So are you a first-time visitor on a Sunday morning? None? Oh, yes. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. We are grateful that you are here with us this morning to worship the Lord. And we know that God will minister to you in a very personal way today. And I'm going to ask Pastor Sandra to declare the blessings of God upon you. Amen.
Hallelujah. Just stay with them and touch their hands or their shoulders and just agree in praying for them as well. Father, we just want to thank you for all these that are visiting with us, God. Father, already there would be an atmosphere, Father, of touching you. Continue to do your work in and through them, God. And Father, if there's any that don't have a relationship, they have never accepted you as Lord and Savior, Father, Jesus is our Jubilee. He came to the cross just for them. And I pray even before this service is finished that they will embrace him, the fullness of all that he has to offer, and they will receive that life, eternal life. Father, we just bless them, protect them, cover all of us, all of them that are visiting. And Father, I pray truly that they would experience all that the Holy Spirit has to offer them and give them in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. And we have no service this coming Wednesday night, but I'd like Tao to come and tell us about a special service that begins on Friday evening. So remember, no service on Wednesday night, but on Friday evening. And I know we had a glorious week in the presence of the Lord last week. Hallelujah. I was not back until late on Wednesday, but I was here on Friday night, and we had a glorious time all through the night. And are there any ones here who have not yet gotten all the sleep that they need to get to replace? Someone once said to me, you can't store up rest. So once you rest and you function, that rest is gone. So we can't restore Friday night's rest, but we can get some rest this afternoon, hopefully. Amen. Tao is going to tell us about what is happening on Friday evening.
Amen. Good morning, church. Are you ready for something new and fresh? We've already got a good dose of that. But starting this Friday, we're having something here called a prophetic explosion. And you know, we are really all about everything that is prophetic and everything that is God and everything that he's doing in this season. So we're having Prophet Brent and Marsha Pedro. I think some of you would remember them. They've been here before, and they're also very good friends of Dwayne and myself and of this ministry. Power Pat ministry is what they deliver. And what I love about them is that even though they are dynamic ministers of God, they're also amazing people, full of character, and they very much love the Lord. So we can really speak for the quality of what you will receive as you come starting on Friday. All the details are probably a bit small for you to read. So it's going to be from Friday, January the 15th, until Sunday the 17th. On the 15th, which is Friday night, we're going to be starting at 7 p.m. Now, all these sessions, I just want you to know, are free except for the breakfast on Saturday morning, which I will come to. And that Friday night session is called the Supernatural Kingdom, and it's going to be a night of prophetic healing and deliverance. And if I just inject a little bit of a testimony, for a few days, I have been semi-struggling with an arm. I don't know if it was an injury. I don't know if it was what. But I would sit down in my vehicle and I would lift my arm and have a lot of pain, just trying to put it up onto the side. I don't know if it was from work or if it was from what, but every time, some people might even see me grimacing to move it if you're sitting on my side over there. And some of you would also have seen me this morning going, it is Jubilee! And, you know, it's like, what happened to the pain? Amen. You know what I mean? I just put my hand up and started to praise God, and hallelujah. Absolutely no pain. And God will work on you in an instant. He'll do it directly for you, but he'll also do it in the midst of an anointed gathering, an anointed setting. And we're going to come believing, as Elder said this morning, when you come with expectancy and there's an atmosphere of belief, God will show up and do amazing and mighty things. So come expecting him to do much that evening. The next day, Saturday morning, we start at 9:30. It's going to be a breakfast session, and that is going to be $25, but there's limited seating. So please get your tickets this morning outside. And it's going to be titled Empowering Marketplace Champions. So if you know that you are called to the marketplace, if you have interest in such, if you're an investor, you're a business owner, etc., that's the place to be. So come now, come quickly. In the evening, we're going to have a session called Empowering Prophetic Teams. So this is for those among you who are called to the ministry of the prophetic ministry, which is pretty much all of us, but those who are believing that they're called and to function in that specific area, that's the place for you, 6 p.m. on Friday evening, and all those sessions are taking place here. Saturday evening, sorry. And on Sunday morning, we're coming back for worship and the word as usual, but we know that as usual is never as usual. So just come and drink, come hungry, and come ready for all that God is going to pour out on this weekend. Now, if you need any more details, the sessions, as I said, are being held here, and you can call us at the office, 429-2527. Might be prophetic. 429-2527. Prophecy. And also, I forgot to mention that coming along with Prophets Brent and Marsha Pedro is young prophet, young in age, not young in stature, Prophet Chiron Regis. He's going to be joining them. He is their right-hand man, one of their right-hand men. So come ready for a true explosion. Pastor said that we are a sheep nation. It's been prophesied over us that we're also a lighthouse nation. And a lighthouse nation is one that draws men unto itself and also declares the glory of God. So that light is going to be explosive this weekend. So bless you, and we look forward to seeing you here.
Amen. We really do look forward to that on Friday evening. So no church on Wednesday, but we meet on Friday evening at 7 o'clock. Apostle, you're up here next. Up here is so hot. Up here is really, really hot. Minister Sonia released some kind of fire up here, and up here is so hot. Did you feel it, Tao? Up here is extremely hot. But anyhow, to God be the glory. Sorry? Do I want the fan? I'll survive. just to let us know that new believers classes will resume, or not resume, this is a new set of new believers classes, which will start on January the 26th at 5:30 p.m. I just want to see those of you who might be in here who did new believers classes last time, but you didn't complete all of them. You didn't start from the beginning. Would you stand? Anybody in here? You didn't start from the very beginning of new believers. So this on January the 26th, then you will be able to come to new believers and do the sessions that you would not have done that started at the very beginning. I don't see anyone else standing, but it is to all new believers who have never done the new believers class. You're invited to join those classes on Tuesday, January the 26th at 5:30 in the evening. And we want to make the body aware at the funeral service for Sister Shirley Corbin will be held on Friday coming right here at 1:30 in the afternoon. And then the interment will be at Cowell Ridge. So we are encouraging the church to come out on Friday afternoon at 1:30 as we support Shirley Corbin, a longstanding partner of this ministry, and also her children as well. And we look forward to seeing you. We fill the jar. We are going to count it this week, and we will let you know next week, God willing, how much was in that big, heavy jar. And you did an overflow, so this is significant of Jubilee because you were given $16, and you have an overflow, so we are starting not from zero. Amen? We are starting. None of us are starting from zero, right? We're starting with something already in the bank. Isn't that good? Amen.
So we will have more than enough. And so let's have our dollar drive at this time. Let's celebrate with the January babies. And is there anyone in the service who's having a birthday today at this coming week? Hallelujah. Dawn Marie jumps to her feet. Anybody else? Amen. Amen. We give God thanks for your life. We are so grateful that you are here in this season. May the Lord continue to bless you. Amen. And fulfill his purpose in your life. Is someone going to sing for us?
A happy birthday to you. May the good Lord bless you. And in all that you do, may the good Lord bless you. Happy birthday to you. Health and strength to you too. And in all that you do, may the good Lord bless you. A happy birthday to you. Health and strength to you too. And in all that you do, may the good Lord bless you. Happy birthday to you. Health and strength to you too. And in all that you do, may the good Lord bless you. To you, grant little health and strength too. And in all that you do, may the good Lord bless you. A happy birthday to you, health and strength to you too. And in all that you do, may the good Lord bless you.
Hallelujah. You recorded that for the new year, Anne? Hallelujah. That's a top band version of happy birthday to you. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. What about those having a wedding? And oh, it was good. It was good top band there. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. I'm settling down, okay? Hallelujah. Those who are having a wedding anniversary today or this coming week, would you stand? Any wedding anniversaries anywhere? Way back in the back. How many years? Start. 30. Hallelujah. And many, 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 many more. May the good Lord bless you. Amen. Amen. Well, it's time for us to give. Hallelujah. God is indeed good. This is our season of fruitfulness. Amen. And so as the ushers come and wait upon you, we just want to bless the Lord. Father, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, for your love. Thank you for your provision in our lives. Thank you, God, that you are always on time. And so, Father, we bless you this morning with our giving. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be able to sow into this marvelous kingdom of God. We thank you, O Lord, for the work that you're doing here in this local assembly, New Dimensions, and the lives that are touched as a result of the giving of your people. God, I thank you that in this season that your people will lack nothing. Father, they will be lenders and not borrowers in the name of Jesus. All that we need will be provided by your hand, God. And we thank you, Lord, that in this time we will not be stingy, but God, we will give unto you and we will give unto each other. In Jesus' name, amen.
Behold, he comes riding on a cloud, shining like the sun.
Just give me a moment to give two more announcements. On the 23rd, Woman of Virtue, we're going to be meeting. Our date is not the last Saturday, but it is the Saturday the 23rd. And on Saturday the 30th, at 6 o'clock in the evening here, we have a very special Jubilee, Sound of Jubilee. What was Jubilee Altar has now become Sound of Jubilee. And it is no longer for the ladies alone. We have done our bit. We have birthed Jubilee, so to speak, into the nation of Barbados. And now the men are coming to help us to raise the Sound of Jubilee. So on Saturday the 30th, everyone is invited, the men, the women, the children, everyone is invited. We are going to be meeting in either Independence Square or Jubilee Gardens. That will be confirmed shortly, but we will be meeting down there. Those who are up to it and able, we'll be meeting there at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We will give you the final details by next Sunday, hopefully, but we are meeting there. Come dressed all in your Jubilee colors. We are going to march either from Independence Square or from Jubilee Gardens right here to the sanctuary, where we are going to have a Sound of Jubilee session. And we're encouraging and inviting other churches and other pastors to be a part of this as we as a nation raise the Sound of Jubilee. Amen? We're excited about that. I read an article briefly last night in the paper where someone wrote a letter asking about, talking about the opening that was held on Wednesday evening and whether or not it is going to be all of this all the time for the next 300 and whatever days. But we are going to come and declare the Sound of Jubilee as the Lord will bless our nation, not just with all the stuff that they may do, but we are going to declare the blessings of God over this nation. We are going to declare over this land that it shall be fruitful and that we will benefit from the Jubilee season. Amen. So God bless you. Thank you for giving, and I'll come down. Thank you.
Good morning. How many know that God is faithful? I just want to minister this song to you this morning. You know, sometimes we get busy and forget about God at times, and then sometimes you remember you need something in your life, and then God comes through for you, and then you start to praise and say, God, you are so faithful. And this morning, I just want to minister this song to you. And I pray that your hearts will be blessed.
In my moments of fear,
through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love, he's proved faithful to me. Every word he's promised is true. What I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Looking back, his love and mercy I see. When my heart looked away, the many times I could not pray, even then God was faithful to me. The days I spent so selfishly reaching out for what pleased me, even then, God's been faithful to me. Every time I come back to Him, He is waiting with open arms, and I see once again.
Amen. That's our God, huh? Faithful, faithful God. Thank you very much, Carol. God bless you. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness. Even when we weren't faithful, he's still faithful. Oh, we can never stop giving him the praise. Hallelujah. Let me just thank those of you who turned out during the week for a time of prayer and fast. I want to bless God for you. And we had a tremendous week in God's presence. I mean, really powerful. And what blessed my heart was the amount of people that turned out every night. Was tremendous. Thank you so much. And then on Friday evening for our all night of prayer, we had over 300 people going through the night with us. I mean, that's a great testimony of God's goodness. And we went through, had a great time in God's presence. So thank you. Let's keep pressing in. Let's keep going forward in God. Let's keep on pursuing the things of God. And let's not go back to where we were. No going back. We've tasted, and there's more to get. Amen. Also, let me just reiterate and encourage you. Reiterate about the services this coming weekend. Encourage you to be out. This entire weekend is sponsored by this ministry. And Prophet Brent and Prophet Marsha, they're coming up. And also their son in the Lord. We look forward for a great time. Friday evening at 7, we want you to come out. Even the numbers and more that were out for prayer and fasting, let's come out and let's hear from the word of the Lord. Prophet Brent is one of my sons in the Lord. As he draws on us for guidance, God has just opened the door for a new building for them, and they've moved in, and they're seeing the goodness of the Lord. Prophet Dwayne and myself have been down there several times, and Prophet Dwayne more often than me, but he's doing a tremendous work in Trinidad down south. In the Marbella area, so continue to pray for him and the team as they come up, I think Friday morning as they come up. So we look forward to having you on Friday night, 7 o'clock, for a great time in God's presence. And then, as we said, there'll be no service on Wednesday because we are starting the weekend prophetic explosion on Friday. But the following week, we want to get back into prayer. I really felt with the Lord we need to spend a few more weeks in prayer. So every Wednesday evening at 6 o'clock, we'll come together for prayer and seeking the face of God. And God has been even impressing upon my heart to let's press in some more. All right? So we're not going into Bible study immediately. We're going into God. And we were pressing with some more prayer. So we look forward to that. But I want to get into the word of the Lord. My voice is a little bit bassy for lack of sleep. So give me a bit more treble, not trouble. Yeah, they say you can't catch up on rest, but you can catch up on sleep. I can. So I want to catch up on sleep. After our prayer and fast yesterday, Pastor and I stayed on for the funeral service, to conduct the funeral service. And then we got in after 1 o'clock. So it's been good. Yeah. Let's get back into the book of Revelation. And we want to read from Revelation chapter 1. And verse 10 to 20. I'm going to ask Elder Clifford if you can read that for us from the New King James Version. Last week, we started to talk about the church at Ephesus, and I want to finish off today. I want to finish off Ephesus and then go into the church at Smyrna and hear what God, and hear what God is saying to to this church today. So we want to finish off the things that God said to Ephesus and then into the message of Jesus to Smyrna. All right? Revelation chapter 1, verse 10 to verse 20. Revelation 1, verse 10 to 20. 11 verses. Let's go together. Yeah.
I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet saying, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what you see, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, Smyrna, to Pergamos, to Thyatira, to Sardis, and to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet, and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice as the song of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. Write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after this. The mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches.
So last week we started to talk about the church at Ephesus and the message Jesus sent to them, how he said he knew their works or their deeds and their labor, their perseverance, how they hated wickedness or evil. And then Jesus said, I have this against you. You've left your first love or forsaken your first love. And he said, repent and do the first works. Return to what you used to do and do the first works. And the whole thing about them is that they were working for God diligently. They worked hard. They persevered. But yet, they were doing it merely out of duty, but not out of relationship with God. And God was calling them back to their first love. In other words, God first, not works. And the Lord has been challenging us. He started last week, even throughout our time of fasting, challenging the church so that we can reorder our lives and get into the place that God wants us to be. Get into divine order and prophetic alignment. And God challenged us last week, and he said, don't forsake your first love. And if we've left it, get back to it and do the first works. The thing that is paramount to God is not the works you do for him, but the love you have for him and the relationship you have with him. He will reward us according to our works. But if you have works without relationship, where we read from the book of Matthew, where Jesus said, depart from me, the people said, you, but we did this in your name, and we cast out demons, and we did miracles, and Jesus said, I never knew you. We never had an intimate relationship. You did works, but there was There was no relationship. And God is calling his church to a place of relationship. God first. Let's get back to the first things. The first works is not service. The first works is worship. So he's calling us so that service for God will come out of a place of worship. And when I say worship, I don't mean raising your hands and singing. All right? Those are expressions of worship. When I say worship, I'm talking about love and devotion for God, honoring God, having him as first place in our lives. No other gods. He must be the only one. He's the one we shall passionately seek after. He should come before our job, before our family, before our spouse, before everything else. He's the one that we should be craving after. Amen? Like the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. My soul feels dry without you. That's the kind of a relationship we should have with God. I have that love relationship with him. So he's calling his church back to its first love. God first. Everything else must take its place. Priority number one, relationship with God. Not service, but worship. We tend to think worship as a lot of what we did today, and we confuse the expression of worship. And again, let me call that works for the sake of what I'm saying to you today. We look at works, and we know that God will honor works, and he loves the works we do for him. But our devotion to him, our love for him, our hearts panting after him, that's what he wants more than anything else. I'll never forget the story with Mary and Martha. And most of us know it. Both of them worked. But Jesus came home by them, and he was just chilling and talking with others. And there's Mary sitting down, gazing at him, drawing everything out of mouth, worshiping, sitting at his feet. And Martha, nothing wrong with what she did. In the kitchen, I must prepare something for Jesus. He must eat something. And Martha is busy, but Mary didn't come in to help. And Mary came, Martha came and complained to Jesus. Tell my sister, get up from there at your feet, just gazing on you, drinking in every word of your mouth, come and help me in the kitchen. And Jesus said, Martha, Martha, let me put it in my mouth. You're worrying about little things. Mary has chosen the better. He's not discounting what Martha did. To say that Mary has chosen the better thing meant that what Martha was doing was good. But Jesus isn't so worried about eating. What gets him is when we sit at his feet and gaze into his face and receive from him. That gets him going. He was trying to show Martha, I can go hungry. That's no issue for me. But what fills me up is when my people just want me. And want every word that comes out of my mouth. When they're not worried about eating, but just worshiping me and adoring me. That fills me up. If we can fill up the heart of God, it's not just what we do for him. It is good. But worshiping him and adoring him and loving him is better. You got what I'm saying? So he said, Mary has chosen the better thing. Let's choose the better thing. Going after God with all of our hearts. That gives him pleasure. And then Jesus goes on. We want to get into now. In Revelation chapter 2 and verse 6. Jesus comes back and said, but you have this. You have. You hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. So they were working. They hated evil, but they had left their first love. And Jesus called them back to their first love. And he said, but you have this one. You hate what I hate. You hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. The word Nicolaitan in the Greek is Nicolaites. It is a compound Greek word. Nicolaites is a compound Greek word. It's comprised of of two Greek words. The first one is nikos, and the second word is leites. The first word, nikos, means a victory, a conquest, a triumph. Or one that is conquered. And by implication, it means dominance over someone that's been defeated. So they're already defeated, but then you take dominance over them. And leites comes from the Greek word leos, which means people. From where you get the English word laity. Leites comes from leos, which we get the word people or laity, as we call it. So if you put the two words together, nikos and laites, you get conquering the people, having dominance over the laity. And immediately, we get the understanding who the Nicolaitans were, because the Bible doesn't talk much about them, anything at all about them. So to understand why God hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans, not hated the Nicolaitans, but why God hated the deeds, the understanding is in the Greek word itself. Those were the people who dominated the laity. So the Nicolaitans were church leaders who lorded authority over God's people and controlled them. By definition, the deeds of the Nicolaitans are this. The leadership of the church, or some of the leaders in the church, manipulated and controlled the laity through fear and intimidation until the people were compelled to submit to their dominance. This is nothing short of what I call charismatic witchcraft. Charismatic witchcraft. Controlling people through dominance, through intimidation, through fear. That is why God said he hates their deeds. Because Jesus plainly said that the Gentiles lord authority over their people, but in the kingdom it is not so. So this set of people in the church, they rose to become leaders, and they were lording authority over God's people and controlling God's people through fear and intimidation. And God does not like that. Many Christians today have been burnt and hurt by church leaders who have controlled and manipulated them through threats and intimidation, and have produced timidity and fear in their congregations. That's not the spirit of Christ. The spirit of Christ is not to threaten people and intimidate people. These church leaders, these pastors, have abused and mistreated the flock of God. And some of them are right here in Barbados. As a result, the Christians have either left the faith altogether because they were hurt, or they have been severely wounded and have not truly lived up to their potential. That's why God hates those deeds. Or you find Christians that are afraid to leave that church because they're already conquered, and because of fear of victimization, they stay under it. Some were brave to leave, but they've gone and have left and gone to other churches, but they're too wounded to trust their new pastor. So they assume that the new church they're in with a new pastor is just like their old pastor. And so they can never reach their fullest potential. They can never work for God as they should. And they remain serving God, but severely wounded. And Jesus makes it clear. He had children. He was speaking about those in the kingdom while giving an example of a child. And he says, anyone who misleads them or hurt them, it'd be better for millstone to be hung around their necks and for them to be cast into the depths of the sea. In other words, Jesus takes it personal. When church leaders hurt their flock by the words that come out from the pulpit, and many people today are severely wounded and cannot reach out to God as they should. The flock has been stripped of dignity and so much fear in their hearts, where people are in church trying to serve God but cannot even approach their leaders and say good morning. That's why God says, I don't like it. And when God says he hates something, he doesn't say that much. Very few times in the word God says, I hate a thing. When God says, I hate it, watch out. It's detestable unto God when he says, I hate a thing. And when in Proverbs says six things God dislikes, but the seventh. So we have to be careful, whether we're pastors or teachers or prophets or whoever we are, or whether we're heads of a ministry, we do not lord authority over people. We serve. Our calling is to serve the body. We are not their master. We don't have slaves or servants. We are the servants. So we are here to serve the flock of God and to feed the flock of God and to watch over their souls, as Apostle Paul said, not manipulate them. Not to be high-handed or heavy-handed. Not to come down upon them and use the pulpit as a means of striking God's flock. It's a serious thing when God gets something he hates. Because if God says, I will deal later on, when he was talking to another church, he said, he didn't even say about their deeds now, he said about their doctrine. Because when you move from manipulating, you begin to interpret things in the word to just hit out at the people, and it becomes strange doctrine. And later on, when God was talking to another church, he said, their doctrine, I will deal with them. So we got to understand as leaders, whether we're ministerial leaders or whether we're heads of ministries, we are called to serve the people. Not shout at them and bawl them out and make people feel less than they are. We're here to raise them up, to raise their level, to raise their standard, to cause them to know that they're loved and they're cared for. That's the calling upon our lives. And anything less, we got to deal with God. Because Paul says of us that we have to give an account before God. I have to give an account concerning every one of you. How I pastored you. How I dealt with you. So when you get to heaven, you hey Jesus, I'm making, he say, come in. And I go, Jesus, I may say, hold on. You have a few hundred people that you gotta talk to me about. See, you talk about you, your spouse, your children, 4, 5, 6, but maybe that's why they call it eternity, because we got to stand up there for a long time. To be a leader is a serious thing. And God has called us to function in the spirit of Jesus. Anything else, we become Nicolaitans, operating on a different level. So I just want to sound that out so you know what should be expected of us. We're here to serve you. We're here to take care of you. First Peter chapter 5, verse 1 to 3. It says the elders, and when it says elders, it means church leaders. In the Bibles, elders or eldership refers to the spiritual leadership of the church. whether they're apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, or they hold an office of elders. In the early church, there were the apostles, and you read in the book of Acts, the apostles and elders. Interesting. The apostles and the elders. James, the brother of Jesus, was an elder in the church, and his word had a lot of weight. So even the elders at the church, at the early church, Paul had to report to the elders. So when he came back to Jerusalem, a lot of the apostles were out ministering, but he had to report to James, the elder. And he had to let James know what was going on. Even though he was stationed in Antioch, whenever he came to, Jerusalem, he had to report to the elders. So eldership speaks of the spiritual leadership of the church. And Peter said, the elders who are among you, I exhort. I who am a fellow elder. So he was an apostle, but he said, I'm a fellow elder. And the witness of the suffering of Christ, and also partake of the glory that will be revealed. Here's the challenge. Shepherd the flock of God, which is among you, serving as overseers, not controllers. We're overseers of God's flock, not controllers of them. Not by compulsion, but willingly. Not for dishonest gain, because we're not in it for money. But do it eagerly. Not as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples of the flock. So we're not called to be lords. We're called to be examples. And leaders have to be examples in lifestyle, in speech, in deportment. Men, in so many different areas, we are called to be examples of the flock. And that's why Jesus hated, Jesus said, I hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, because they hurt the people of God. They mistreated them and said unkind things to them. God said, I hate those deeds. And then Jesus concludes by saying, who has an ear? Let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Not to the church. To the churches. Anyone who has an ear. That includes us. To the churches. White churches are not church. He was writing to a church then. Because this message is not for the church at Ephesus only. It's to anyone who reads the message, including us, including this church. Those who have an ear hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. To him who overcomes. And we want to finish off with this. Revelation chapter 2. Let's look at it for a moment. Here's some interesting things that Jesus is saying to the church. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So whenever you overcome, there's a reward. Jesus said, I will cause you to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So he commended them. He chided them. He commended them again. And now he says to them, if you overcome, these are the rewards for you. Then he goes into the next church, the church at Smyrna. This message to the church at Smyrna is the shortest of the seven messages that Jesus sent out. And it contains no reproof, only encouragement. Yet there are some things that we can learn from this message as we continue to reorder our lives. Smyrna was a city, a seaport city, about 35 miles north of Ephesus. It's been described as one of the most beautiful cities in Asia Minor, which is present there, Turkey. Today in Turkey, it is called Izmir. Scripture doesn't really give information about who founded the church. It does not even call the church by name. The only clue we have from it is when Paul was at Ephesus, the Bible says all those in Asia or Asia Minor heard the word of the Lord. So we can assume from this, as is mentioned in Acts chapter 19, verse 10, that when Paul spent 3 years at Ephesus, there was an outreach because he was there with Aquila and Priscilla, and he was also there with Luke and some other members of his team. It is believed that he sent some people out to other places like Laodicea and Smyrna and all of those to share the word of the Lord. The Greek word translated Smyrna is used in the Greek Old Testament to translate a Hebrew word for myrrh, M-Y-R-R-H. Myrrh is a kind of a sticky substance used as a perfume for the living and the preparation of the dead for burial. So its association with death perfectly pictures the suffering church at Smyrna. We want to read what God said of them. So let's go into the word of the Lord. Revelation chapter 2, from verse 8 to verse 11. Revelation chapter 2, verse 8 to 11. I want to read it. And to the angel, or to the messenger of the church in Smyrna, write, these things says the first and the last, who was dead and came to life. I know your works, tribulation and poverty, but you are rich. And I know the blasphemy of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue or the congregation of Satan. Do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes shall not be hurt by the second death. So Jesus said to them in verse 8, these things says the first and the last, who was dead and came to life. In each of the letters, as you read them, and I will challenge you to read them sometime this week, Jesus, read chapter 1 and chapter 2, and then to chapter 3, 1, 2, and 3 of the book of Revelation. And Revelation is not a book to be scared of. I know people avoid Revelation because it says scary. Remember, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ and not the revelation of the Antichrist. Remember, Jesus, whatever God does for his church, Satan tries to copy. God says, you are marked, so the Antichrist tried to mark his own. Watch it. It's a beautiful book. And it's probably the only book in the Bible that God says, blessed are those who read this book. So you want to be blessed? Read Revelation. She said, blessed are those who read this book. So read it. Anyway, to every church, Jesus selects the title of himself from chapter 1 and applies as he speaks to every church. And he says in verse 9, I know your works, I know your tribulation, I know your poverty, but you are rich. And I know the blasphemy of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. First of all, he said, I know your works or your deeds. I know the things you do. Most of the recent translations, like the NIV Message Bible and the New Living Translation, omits the word works, as they're not in later manuscripts. But Jesus said, I know your works. I know the things you're doing for me. I know your deeds. I know everything about you. I know your tribulation or your persecution. That term tribulation means persecution, trouble, suffering, distress, oppression. Jesus said, I know what you're going through. I know what you're doing for me, but I also know what you're going through. You know, you may think that a church that is going through a lot of persecution, a lot of oppression, a lot of suffering, you would think that something is wrong with that church. If you read about this church, you would think from all they went through, poor, tribulation, suffering, persecution, you may think that something is wrong with them. Something has to be wrong with them that they're going through so much. You know, that's the first thing we say when we have to go through something, or when someone is going through a rough patch of their life. The first thing we say, what have I done wrong? Something must be wrong. Why is that church going through so much? Somebody must have sinned. Something got to be wrong with the pastor. His life got to be out of order. The first thing we say is somebody's trying to work witchcraft. Because we think when we go through something hard or some kind of suffering or persecution that something is wrong with us. Not necessarily. But this message from Jesus to the Smyrnas, I call them, is actually a message of encouragement to people that were going through severe persecution. There's no rebuke. There's no correction. In other words, Jesus finds no fault in this church. Yet they're called to go through much tribulation, much troubling for the sake of Jesus. Myrrh was produced. We know about myrrh. Myrrh was produced by crushing the plant. And when the plant was crushed, the fragrance emanated as a result. In the same way, the church in Smyrna were crushed by much persecution. But they gave off a fragrant aroma of faithfulness to God. Jesus said, I know your persecution. I know you're going through tremendous persecution. Some here today are called to go through much trials, many trials. It seems as though when one is over, something else happens. Or somebody is always mistrusting you or talking your name or saying something bad about you. And when you finally try to prove yourself, someone else talks about you. And it seems you're the subject of people for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And snacks too. And for some reason, as much as you try, their people don't like you. Jesus says, I know. It has not gone unnoticed. I see what you're going through. And many of you have asked God, God, what's wrong with me? I want to say to you, quit trying. Quit trying to make people like you. God loves you. Quit trying to please people and please God. Because the same people that spread their garments down and say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. The next week, we're saying, crucify him. I want to tell you, when God is for you, he is for you. So don't worry about who, like, somebody's always talking about me. I prefer to say God is always thinking good plans for me. So stop worrying about who don't like you or who talks about you. You got to be important if somebody is talking about you all the time.
And the church has to come to a place where we understand that somebody talking about us is absolutely nothing. It hurts. We prefer everybody, especially our brothers and sisters, to think good things and to say good things about, but not everybody going to understand you. Especially not the place where God is calling us and the standards that God has established among us. Everybody's not going to understand what change has taken place in your life. Because of where you're going with God, you can get more talk. I want to say to you, I want to suggest to you, that if you're going through what we call the ringer, do it as unto God. Be faithful in the midst of your pressure, because God says, I know. Nothing goes unnoticed to the eye of God. God knows, and he's there. So Jesus says, I know your suffering. They went through so much pressure, and as a result, they were poor. And you would think that after a church like that had gone through severe persecution, that God will say, in a message to them, Jesus will say, I know your persecution. You've gone through years of persecution, but I have come down to ease your pain, oh my people. We like those kind of prophecies. In verse 10, I want to skip to verse 10 and then I'll come back because it's linked. Jesus said to them, Jesus said, I've not come to ease the pressure you're bearing upon. I've come now to give you a period of time without any trial or persecution. Jesus said, do not fear any of the things which you're about to suffer. What a prophecy. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison. What a prophetic word. So that you will be tested. And you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you a crown of life. So you mean, Jesus, I'm under pressure. And to think you're about to ease it, you send a message by the Apostle John to me, telling me don't be afraid of the things I'm about to go through. Now, if this is hot, and you're telling me don't be afraid of the things I'm about to go through, then you may try to tell me, Jesus, the fire is getting hotter. He says, indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison to be tested. And you have tribulations for 10 days, so the pressure is going to get more intense. But Jesus said, be faithful unto death. So one would think that a church that was under severe persecution, that Jesus would come and say, I've now come to ease your pain. You've been faithful. You've gone through much suffering, so much pressure, and you're poor as a result. But Jesus said, don't be afraid of what you're about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you into prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days, but be faithful. Throughout history, and there's a word for some of you, huh? Some of you have been going through a lot. Here's a word for you. Jesus knows. But here's another word for you. It does not mean because Jesus knows that it will get any lighter. It's all a part of the testing. Jesus said, be faithful. But I don't have any money to pay my bills. Be faithful to him. But every time I try to get out, something else happens. Be faithful to him. All he's calling you to do is to be faithful. Throughout the history of the church, and even taking place today, the purity and strength of the persecuted church has always been apparent. We often describe the treatment of Christians in areas like Asia, places like China, and India, and Pakistan, Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, places like that. We always describe it as very terrible for the church. And we sometimes wonder about the state of the church. And we hurt that they cannot proclaim Jesus Christ openly. Where in those nations there's a low tolerance for the gospel, whether Islam is pushed or atheism is pushed. Some Christians in those areas have been sent to prison. Some are being martyred. Some have their heads chopped off or cut off. And we wonder, how can it be with the church there? They must be living in fear. Things must be really bad for them. We either have heard or we have seen or read for ourselves the power of the church that's under severe persecution. How blessed that church is. We call them the suffering church. And we don't see them as the pure church. But that church that's under severe persecution, they're seeing miracles that we don't see. There's a purity that comes from them that we have not yet experienced. And some of the things we're praying to see, they're experiencing. There's a genuineness, a deep spirituality, a humility, a strong zeal for God, and a single-minded devotion to the Lord, and a love for the Word of God that exists in what we call the suffering church. If we call them the suffering church, and they're like that, I guess we're the suffering ones. Yeah. 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 10 says, "But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you." So we know that the church that suffers is a church that's pure. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Verse 3 to 4, we are bound to thank God always for you, brethren. And it is fitting, because your faith grows exceedingly, and the love of every one of you all abounds toward each other, so that we ourselves boast of you among the churches of God for your patience and your faith in all your persecution and tribulations that you endure. Paul is saying, you've gone through a lot, Thessalonians. Tremendous persecution, tremendous pressure. But we boast about you because your faith has grown exceedingly. Your love for one another abounds. And we thank God for your patience and your faith as you go through persecutions. Jesus said to the church at Smyrna, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of what you're about to go through. And I want to say to this church, don't be afraid of persecution or suffering or pressure. As we have made a decision to go after God with our whole hearts, as we have decided that we are returning to our first love, as we've made a commitment to God, even last week, that we're going after the things of God, I want to say to you, you're not just attracting God, but hell has heard. And there's nothing to be afraid of. We have committed ourselves to pursue God with our whole hearts. And you think that after we have prayed and fasted as we did, and rededicated our lives to God, and to a place of constant prayer, that the devil will leave us alone? He will come after you to frustrate you. He will come after us to divide us. He will come after us to force us into going back to where we were. But I want to say to us, we are moving forward. Amen. We are going after God with all of our hearts. And we are reordering our lives and getting into divine order. The devil, hear me, he will try. If he hasn't done it yesterday after our prayer and fast. Some of you step into your homes or step into your workplaces. Bam! But I want to say that the trials that we will go through are a part of the building up in our lives so that our lives can come into divine order. Don't be afraid of the stuff you will go through. Don't be afraid of the criticisms you will get. Don't be afraid if the pressure gets hotter. It's all a part of us making a declaration. We are going to reorder our lives. It's a process that some of us will walk through. But I said we are going to walk through. We're not going to die in the midst of it. We're going to come out better and stronger. Amen. It's like now New Dimensions has been called to swim against the tide. Swimming against the tide calls for more effort. It calls sometimes for more struggling. It calls for using more muscles than you use when you were going with the tide. But we're swimming against the current because we're swimming toward God. And I want to say this church will be stronger. Love will flow like never before. This church will be a pure church. This church will be filled with the power of God. The presence of God will be felt from the time you step through that gate. Amen. This whole compound will be a place separated unto God. So the pressures will come. The attacks will come. The misunderstandings will come. I said they will, not they might. We'll come to our place in our pursuit for God and our determination for him and the unusual supernatural things that will be taking place. That publicly we'll be criticized. We may be the subject of talk shows. People may call us weird. But we will not turn back. We make a decision. I will not go back. God has called us to something powerful. We will not go back. And we will take one another by the hand. If we see a brother or sister that's going with the current, we will say, no, wrong direction. Because I'm my brother's keeper. I have a right to look out for you. You have a right to look out for me. And don't get upset and offended when we say to you, that's not right. Come, we've got to go in the right direction. It's for your own good. I said already, I'll say again. As you draw closer to God, you will get some friends who can't handle the new you. You will have some of your present friends who can't handle the new you. Some of them will break off relationship with you, break off their friendship, calling you weird. Your workmates may disassociate themselves from you, telling you you're different now. People will criticize you, even in your home. Your unsaved loved ones may be critical of the new standard of God in your life, your new standards for God. It's stuff you used to watch on TV, you can't stomach that any longer. And they want to know what's wrong with you, but let them know everything is right. The devil will go all out in his limited power to discourage you and to hurt you. What we're saying together, we're not going back. I won't go back. I can't go back to the way it used to be. I must go forward in God. I felt this week like I got saved all over again. In fact, from Monday night, I went home saying I got saved. It felt much better than when I got saved the first time. Your apostle got saved on Monday. Oh, it felt so good. But already last week, the devil started to hit at me. I mean hit at me. Cruelly hitting at me. And I'm smiling and saying, try your best, but I ain't going back. Or in fact, do your worst. The pressure that some of us will go through are to test us. But we will pass every test. Amen. But Jesus also said of them in verse 9, the first part, I know your poverty, but you are rich. In the Greek, the word poverty, that word poverty there, or the word I know your poverty, carries the idea of not just poor. But it carries the idea, that particular Greek word employed for poverty, it carries the idea of utter destitution. I mean, poor. Smyrna was a very wealthy city in Asia Minor. It was a wealthy city with its popular harbor, which made shipping and trading very convenient. The economy in Smyrna was very strong. And the city attracted much business from other Roman colonies. As business boomed and money flowed easily, so did wickedness. Yeah, corruption. And because the Christians in Smyrna, so you can understand, Smyrna was a place that the Romans had a lot of interest in. And history tells us that if any emperor of Rome died, they will build a statue to him, calling him a god, only after they died. The Christians at Smyrna refused to worship the Roman emperor. They said, we have one God, one king, and that's Jehovah. And when they refused to do that, the business people refused to buy from those who were Christians or sell to them. If you were Christian, you were fired from your job. And as a result, the church became destitute. But they were rich in Jesus. Amen. And they did not allow the trials they went through to inhibit their growth in Christ. They did not complain and grumble against God. They worshiped more intensely. They served the Lord with gladness. And they pursued the things of God. And God says, I know your poverty, but you are rich. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 32 to 35, the writer to the Hebrews said, remember those earlier days after you had received the light, when you endured a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. And other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property. Because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions, and I insert there in heaven. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. Church at Smyrna was like that. People's properties were confiscated. The church became destitute. But God says, you are rich. You see, to Jesus, earthly wealth or comfort does not necessarily represent spiritual wealth. To Jesus, the man or the woman who's pursuing God and who's faithful to God and whose lives are in alignment with God's plans and purposes and who have a great relationship with God are rich. In fact, Jesus said to another church, and we'll get to that at a later date. Jesus said, you say you are wealthy, but you're poor. You said you're well clothed, but you're naked. Because they had tremendous wealth. The church was wealthy. And because they were wealthy, they lost sight of God. Their focus was too much on their wealth. The church at Smyrna, they were different. They were destitute. They had no other thing, no other choice, no other option but to look to God. They were under severe persecution. They had no other distractions. They looked to God. I'd rather be poor and going all out for God than to be wealthy and in a state of dryness and dead. Because one of these days our wealth will come to an end. In fact, one of these days we will come to an end. What will become of our wealth? You see, I can handle being wealthy and going after God, okay? You can understand? But if wealth is going to take our attention off God, then I'd rather be poor. In the third part of verse 9, Jesus said, I know the blasphemy of those who are of the synagogue or of the congregation of the devil. That term blasphemy means to speak against someone in such a way as to damage their reputation, to revile them, to defame them. There was a large and hostile Jewish community at Smyrna because of the trade that was taking place and the strong economy. But they were putting a lot of pressure on the church. Like how Apostle Paul used to do to the church. There were Jews by virtue of being born Jews. But Jesus said of them, they are of the congregation or the synagogue of Satan. Interesting. Jesus speaking of his own people. I want to read it again. I know the blasphemy of those who say they're Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. What Jesus was actually saying, they may be Jews by birth, but not by practice. Paul said, a Jew is not one who's one outwardly, but one who is inwardly. In other words, Jesus said of them, they were doing the work of Satan and putting pressure upon this church. And they were wicked in their deeds because they were following the Romans and all of that and worshiping a lot of strange gods. Jesus said, these can't be Jews. They have the synagogue of Satan. They're hanging with the Romans and doing a lot of evil things. In Matthew chapter 5, as I begin to close, verse 10 to verse 12. Jesus said, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you I lost it. Blessed are you when they revile you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So church, as we have committed ourselves this year to reordering our lives and to coming to divine order and prophetic alignment, some of us may be reviled. When the Spirit of God begins to move in this place in might and power, and God begins to do the unusual in our sight, you will be reviled. I remember when the great revival broke out in Pensacola, Florida. There were some strange things even I didn't understand. When God began to move upon the people in power and might, you would think that the media would celebrate that. Every day, there was some critical thing in the newspapers concerning whether the preaching or what the people are doing or why these people are falling down or why they have to come every night and a lot of stuff. The people were talking a lot of strange things about them. But that wasn't all. Even in magazines like Charisma, the people who are Christians were criticizing the move of God. It's one thing when the unsaved criticize, but when the church, who should understand. And they had media personnel in the service every night, and they will make a report. But some kind of nonsense they were writing and scoffing at what was going on and ridiculing the church. When the Spirit of God begins to move, God does not have to explain a thing to us what he's doing or how he's doing. All he wants us to do is to get into prophetic alignment and move with him. God doesn't have to explain. But God is going to move and people are not going to understand. You got to prepare yourself because some people will be under attack from their workmates. Oh, you're part of that weird church. Please understand that the Bible says, blessed are you when men will revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely. You are blessed when that happens. God says, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. Now hold down your heads and cry. Oh God, why gotta go in this pressure all the time? Why does this have me happen? Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, because great is your reward in heaven. And Jesus ends off, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt by the second death. So this message to Smyrna is for us. Hear what the Spirit says. Persecution does not come because something is wrong. Sometimes it comes because you're doing something right. Trials don't come necessarily because you do something wrong. They come because you make a decision to go forward with God. And I want to say to you today, be encouraged. You're doing a good thing. I really felt, as the leader of this ministry, the full approval of God for what we did during last week. I heard God saying to me, I'm happy. My heart is full. I hear God speaking to me, even into Friday night. I approve what you've done. And I will remember this sacrifice. And I will answer from the heavens. But understand, trouble may very well come in the midst of all of that. But understand also that in the midst of all of that, God is going to come. And if God comes, I don't worry about trouble. He will show forth his glory. He will show forth his power. He will show forth his might. He will pour out his spirit. His spirit will break out in this place. Healings and miracles. And many different things will take place in the midst of this nation. So we got to press in some more. The fast doesn't mean it's over. It's just begun. But I want to encourage you. If the pressure has started, if hell has turned on the heat, know that God will pour out his spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So if we have to go through what we have to go through for God to pour out his spirit, and I say, bring it on. Bring it on. Because there's no temptation or no trial that's come your way that somebody else has not gone through. But God says he's faithful that he will not allow you to be tempted above what we're able to bear, but with the same temptation, make a way of escape. God, do what you need to do so that your spirit can break out in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do what you need to do with us. As we have given ourselves to you afresh and we've rededicated our lives to you, mold us, shape us. But we have determined that we are not going back. Not what we experienced with you last week. If that's just a spoonful, God, we cannot wait for the outpouring. It's like you said, taste this. This is what I'm able to do. Therefore, God, our passion has been awakened for you. And God, we will not stop. I pray for my brothers and sisters. This ministry that you have given me to look after for you. I stand here as a steward of your work. And I bless everyone. I stand here, God, and I declare over them the richness of your grace and an outpouring of your spirit and experiences with you, God, even in their private time with you, even as they spend time in prayer. God, we know that the enemy is attacking our